All right, let's start sculpting. You see that I've started with the Mudbox base head, and I've added some accessories to it, some teeth and some spheres for the eyeball. I'm out of the teeth in Maya. And I'm going to reshape the head around these props so that I can create the overall form first. And I'll be using several major brushes for this. First is the wax brush that I use to build up volume. The next is the foamy brush that I use to cut in sharp details. And the last is the grab tool that I'm using to adjust the shape of the mouth with here. Let's talk about the foamy first. I use it with a very sharp fall off and a negative value to cut detail into the surface. I use it to add very sharp edges to really define features. Wax brush is next. I like the wax brush to add a lot of volume and to build up shapes. So I'm using it here to add eyelids, and then I'll use the foamy brush to cut in around to define them better. I also use the wax brush to cut in for very large areas, so the hollows under the cheeks and in the temples. And then the grab brush I use extensively to make overall changes to the form of my object. So reshaping the size of the skull, repositioning the nose, and repositioning the features of the face on the model. Once the overall structure is there and the basic shapes of the face are there, then I'll focus on adding detail. And usually for the face, this is in the form of blocking out muscle masses. So we don't tend to think of the face as having a lot of muscle, but every movement on the face is defined by muscles. The muscles are located in two key areas, the muscles around the eyes and the muscles around the mouth. So we're working in two radial areas around the eyes and around the mouth. And I'll build up volume here. I'm just using the freeze brush in combination with the grab brush to tilt the jaw to the side a little bit. Now the object is very asymmetrical, so I have to be careful with that. As I'm defining things, I'll be using the grab brush, the negative foamy brush, and the wax brush to better shape the form of the muscles that are defining the character's features. So the overall shape is one aspect, but it's the detail that we put into the fine features that really sells the model as being interesting and lifelike. Not that this guy is at all, you know, lifelike, but you get what I'm saying. All right, now I'm using the pinch brush, and we can see that I'm using it to sharpen the details around the eyes. So the wrinkles in the muscles around the eyes, sharpening the crease of the eyelids so that we get a sharper defined border in that region. And we want to remember that lines on the face or anywhere on the body aren't actually there. There are no lines on the human form the way we would think of lines on, say, a comic book drawing. What we're actually seeing is two different muscle masses pushing up against each other, forming a crease, and that crease creates that illusion of there being a line there. So when we're creating negative lines, as I'm cutting in with my negative foamy brush here, we end up pinching those together to become sharper detail so that they don't look like just these big gouges that we've cut out of clay, but instead they look like two muscles pushing up against each other, creating tension where we end up with that line, and it'll start to read as a little bit more lifelike. One other tip for wrinkles is to blur the end points where the wrinkles meet with the rest of the surface around them. That'll make them feel like they're a part of that surface instead of sitting on top of it. Now, I'll start to use my pinch brush to define the wrinkles around the mouth to really get those laugh lines etched in around his face. And again, we want to remember that we're not trying to create lines, that it is muscular forces pushing up against each other to create those creases, and we want to create those accordingly. Now, because I made my face asymmetrical, I can't paint with symmetry on my brush. We just want to keep that in mind. In some points, we will be able to use symmetry. In other points, we won't be able to use symmetry. We want to keep track of what our brush is doing every time we start painting. Whenever I'm sculpting, I always follow the same general strategy. I'll block in the broad shapes of whatever I'm sculpting, and then I'll start to progressively add more and more detail by adding a little sharpness with the pinch and with the foamy brushes. Whenever we're sculpting, we have to remember that sculpting tools, by their very nature, are very soft. We'll see that as I add the mohawk with the wax brush, the resulting shapes are very soft. And all the brushes do this. As a sculptor, we need to compensate for that and very specifically work on adding the sharpness of detail. In this case, I use the grab brush to add sharp edges to the mohawk. And on the lips, I'll add sharp edges around the edges of the lips, the vermilion border, I think it's called, with the pinch brush. So I'm defining the shape so that we can see that anatomy better. I'll do the same on the nostrils and the edges of the nose. And we can also use the pinch brush to straighten out lines. So wherever we have wobbly lines because our hand wasn't quite steady enough, we can use the pinch brush to smooth those lines out to create nice, soft curves. Watch as I start adding the detail on this cheek. I'll step down to a lower level of resolution. And this is because it's usually a lot easier to smooth detail on those lower mesh levels. So if we're working on a high-res mesh and the smooth doesn't seem to be working very well, we want to step down and use the smooth on a lower level to resolve that problem. And a good example is what I'm doing here around the eye area. I decided I wanted to change the muscles and the detail in that region. Trying to smooth it at a high level of detail gave me poor results, so I stepped down and I'm able to very easily smooth that detail. And then I can go back in and add new detail on the various levels by using my wax and my foamy brush to carve in that sharper area of detail. So adding mass to muscles, I'm working in the nose area here, and I start using the wax, but then I'll switch to using the sculpt brush to get a more rounded bulge. And I'm just trying to emphasize here that I have multiple muscle groups pushing up against each other, and it's those shapes that give us the characteristics that we think of as a face. Next, I'm going to switch gears and work on the neck. Now, with the neck, I don't expect it to receive as much attention as the face of the character. And because it's not going to receive as much attention, I don't want to spend as much time working on it as I would the areas that I know are going to receive a lot of attention. So we just want to remember that as artists, we have a finite amount of time, and we want to spend it where it's going to do us the most good. Okay, I just jumped in from Maya so that we see where these eyeballs are coming from. These are eyes that I have from a different character, and I brought them into Mudbox, and I've frozen them, and I'm going to reposition my eyelids around these eyes. So I'm going to be using the grab brush and the pinch brush to create nice shapes. And similarly, I'm importing these eyelashes in. And I'll try and edit them in Mudbox using my grab brush to position them. But Mudbox will only let me position one at a time. It'll take forever to do it that way. So I need to go back into Maya, use my move tool, and I'm going to turn my soft selection on. And if I set my soft selection to volume, the effect won't be limited to the immediate object. It will spread to the objects around it. That'll allow me to very easily make the changes that I need. Only one other point I'll make here, using the right tool for the job makes that job a lot easier. All right, so eye area, let's do the eyebrows. I'll start by using that foamy brush. Instead of using it negative, I'll use it positive. And I'll do it on a separate layer so that I can use the erase tool to blur the edges of it so that the edges kind of fade into the surface of the skin. And with the erase tool, anytime we're using that, we want to use it at a relatively low opacity. And then I'll use the pinch tool to kind of sharpen those strokes so that they become a little bit more ridged. And then I'll go through and I'll smooth over the middle area, and that'll blend it all together, and it'll create something that looks like a hole instead of discrete strokes. Up next is our hairbrush. We can see that I've created a brush in Photoshop. It looks like three blobs of white. And when I use that with the repeat brush in Mudbox, it gives us something that does do a nice job of creating a sculptural looking effect for the hair. So I'll go over the entire mohawk with this, and I'll use larger brush strokes to fill in big areas, and then I'll use smaller brush strokes to create more of a fine detail look. Also go in and add individual strokes using the sharp negative foamy brush along the base of the mohawk to kind of ground it to the head. Just wherever else I feel like I need to add detail to it as well. So speaking of detail, let's add some skin detail to our object. I'm going to use my spray brush with a cellular texture on it. And for all these skin brushes, these are brushes that I found online. So you can search for Mudbox brushes. You can also search for ZBrush alphas. You'll be able to use those as textures as well. So to create this skin, we're going to have three kind of separate effects. The skin effect that we can see here, that we're just going to cover the entire surface, and we want this on its own layer so we can control the strength of it. The next effect that we're going to add is large pores, and the large pores are typically concentrated in the cheek area, on the nose a little bit, and on the chin. We'll also have small pores, and these are generally everywhere that the big pores are not. And then we'll also want to have some transition between the two, so something that transitions from the big pores to the small pores on the sides. Fine resolution detail like this can be difficult to see. We may have to zoom in from Mudbox to render it properly. It can be helpful to go to our viewport filters and turn on cavity ambient occlusion. Now onto the lips detail. I'm just using that same hairbrush that I used on the Mohawk to create the overall wrinkles on the lips, and then I'll smooth those to blend them into the rest of the surface. Anytime we're working with fine details like these, we want to put it on its own sculpting layer so that we can make changes to just that layer alone. Now I'm going to add wrinkles to the surface of this skin. And this is another repeat brush that I'm using here. Someone created this really cool wrinkle brush. I think I found it on the ZBrush Central forums. And we can see the wrinkles here on their own. And you'll see that I've turned the layers for all the other effects off, the pores and the skin detailing. And this allows me to work exclusively on the wrinkles. So I'm just going to smooth them out a little bit so that they blend into the surface of the skin better, so that they don't look quite so sharp-edged and ragged. Up next is some simple texture painting. I'm going to paint the Mohawk here. And because this is just a color layer, I'm just going to create a low-res texture, use my spray brush to apply the red to the surface, and then use the erase tool to get rid of any overspray onto the surface. Next, I'll use the burn tool around the base of the Mohawk to create a darker base that'll just kind of anchor it to the head just a little bit better. Kind of also looks like a dyed hair. I'll use the dodge tool on the tips of the Mohawk to make it a little bit brighter and more vibrant and draw attention to that area. And then I'll use both sets of tools to brighten and darken here and there, basically create kind of groups or clumps of hair. And this is this subtle kind of detail that just adds a little bit of interest that the viewer won't notice, but they will notice if it's not there. Next is painting the face. I've got the base color, just a flesh tone, and I'll start with a reddish pinkish color. And I'm going to paint that in everywhere where there are blood vessels kind of close to the surface of the skin. So that's typically around the eyes, the cheek area, a little bit into the chin, the neck, and then a little bit on the forehead. Of course, the ears are going to be pinkish as well. And I'll end up with a sunburnt looking person. And then I'll use the blur brush to kind of spread that paint detail across the surface of the object to create a more even feel. I'll go back in with that burn brush and just burn around the eyes. I'll color in the lips with a kind of reddish brownish color, and again I'll use the blur tool to kind of smooth that into the surface. Then the next thing that I'll work on is the eyebrows, and you'll see that I paint the eyebrows in really sloppy, and I'll use the blur tool to kind of blur it into the surface so it fits. And I'll do something very similar for the forehead vein. I'll use a purplish color, and I'll set the strength to be very low, and I'll paint that in and just kind of blend it into the surface. Now let's do some stubble for the shaved area of this guy's head. So I've created a new texture layer, but it's a bump layer, it's not a diffuse layer. And I'll use my paintbrush with a noisy spray attached to it, and I'll just spray that all over the areas that there would be stubble. So along the shaved head and where his beard would be. And now the trick is to make our color map match this stubble. So what we'll do is we'll finish the stubble, and then we'll duplicate selected that stubble layer. So right click, duplicate selected, and then right click, move selected, move it to the diffuse. So that'll take the stubble texture that we just created, it'll duplicate it, it'll move it to the diffuse. So now we've got a color that looks like the stubble that we painted. And I'm going to invert it so that it's black instead of white. And lastly, I'll create a new layer and I'll choose a bluish grayish tint, and I'll just spray that blue gray into the areas where we have that stubble. And I'll spray it with a noisy brush, and like I did with the skin, I'll then use the blur and just blend it into the painting around it. Yeah, and that's about all there is to this guy. A little bit of sculpting, a little bit of painting, some trickery with the bump out.